Hello, everyone. Welcome to the St. Louis Art Museum's Art Speaks program. My name is Jessica Kennedy, and I'm the educator for adult learning at the museum. Before we begin, please familiarize yourself with the Q&A section located on your screen. Feel free to enter your questions at any time during the program, and we will choose a few to answer at the end. Also, there is live auto transcription available for this program. Please click the CC icon to activate or deactivate the subtitles. For today's talk, The Royal Women of Napata, we are joined by Denise Doxey, the curator of Ancient Egyptian, Nubian, and Near Eastern Art at the Museum of Fine Arts, Boston, and the visiting curator for the exhibition that is currently on view at the museum titled Nubia, Treasures of Ancient Africa. Thanks so much for being here today, Denise.
Thank you very much, and thanks all of you for joining us this afternoon. Today, we are going to be visiting the site of Napata, which is located in the northern part of Sudan, right near this big bend of the Nile. And Napata was the capital city of an extensive Kushite empire to the south of Egypt from about the mid-9th to the mid-4th century, and the burial place of its kings and royal families. The Jebel Barkal right here is the modern name of the site of Napata. And here we have two cemeteries, the earlier cemetery at El Kuru, just a little bit downstream, and then later across the river at Nuri. And today we'll be visiting exclusively the tombs from El Kuru. And although I call this the Royal Women of Napata, they are in fact only the royal women of a single reign during Napata, the early part of the history. So the Harvard University Boston Museum of Fine Arts expedition excavated at El Kuru in 1919. And here you see the excavations in progress. The tombs of the kings and certain of the queens were pyramids. And here you can see the entrance to one of them, but all of the stone from all of the pyramids have been, all but one, have been completely quarried away in modern times. So there's actually no pyramids left to see at this particular site. And here you see Jebel Barkal from an aerial view and from a distance. And Jebel Barkal was the most sacred place in of the Napatan kingdom, and undoubtedly the reason that the capital city was put there. It was believed to be the dwelling place of Amun, who is a ram-headed god who is the most senior deity in their pantheon, and he was believed to dwell inside the mountain. So over the years, a series of kings built temples at the base of the mountain, including the king we're going to be talking about today, who is Piankhy. Some people prefer to pronounce the name P-A, but that's a whole different discussion for another day. And so here you see him on one of the monuments he left at Jebel Barkal, accompanied by Amun-Ra and his wife, Mut, receiving tribute from a pair of defeated Egyptians. So what happened during the reign of Piankhy is that Egypt became fractured in this sort of civil war. But the priesthood of Amun at Thebes, which was the most powerful group of people in southern Egypt at the time, remained very closely attached to the cult of Amun at Napata. So when they were faced with the threat from their northern neighbors, they turned to Piankhy for assistance and protection. And he took them up on that and proceeded to conquer all of the rival kings throughout Egypt and united the entire country of Egypt and Nubia from what is now Khartoum to the Mediterranean. So the entire Nile Valley came under the control of the Napatans. And Piankhy and his four immediate successors ruled Egypt as Egypt's 25th dynasty. Now we know from inscriptional evidence that Piankhy had at least four wives. One of them is Queen Abar, and no one knows where she is buried, possibly one of the tombs we'll be looking at later. Queen Pexater, who was buried in Egypt at the site of Abydos. Queen Tabiri and Queen Kensa, both of whom we'll be seeing today. I should point out that all of these tombs were robbed in antiquity, so what remains is only a small hint of what might once have been in these tombs. So let's start with Kensa. Kensa appears to have been the most important of Piankhy's wives, and she was given the honor of being buried on the high ridge of, with the pyramids of the kings and certain other queens. So here you see Piankhy's tomb and Kensa's tomb. Among the sort of enigmatic objects from King's system are these two objects, a pair of bronze poles that are the end of the shape of human hands wearing elaborate cloisonné necklaces, most of the enamel is now missing, and holding these tubes in their hands. Because of representations of the kings and queens in artwork, showing them with servants accompanying them, carrying canopies over their head to shade them from the sun, the excavators of the site, Joy Fraser and Palestina, speculated that these were canopy poles. And I have no better suggestion, so I'm following their suggestion that that could very well be Adam's function. Now, this is the entrance to the burial chamber of Queen Hansa at the bottom of the stairs. And here you see right here those two bronze carrying, or possibly canopy poles. And then over here there's a very, very large bronze vessel in which there's a smaller cylindrical vessel. And that is this object right here. It's a silver bowl. Silver was very uncommon in Nubia, where gold was very abundant. So this is a very large silver vessel by the standards of what they usually made with silver, with her name inscribed on it. And it was accompanied by, I apologize for the quality of the photo, a smaller silver cup with a double spout and the top half of it half covered. It is thought that these two objects were used as part of a funerary ritual, that a liquid, possibly milk, was poured from this cup into the cylindrical vessel. And the reason the top is that way covered is to keep it from splashing out over the edge when the libation is being poured. Now, Queen Hansa seems to have had an interest in geology and natural history, because in her tomb was a large collection of interestingly shaped stones, fossils, and other such things. But she also included artificial examples of the same sorts of things. These objects, this small snail shell, which is actually very realistically carved and inscribed in the inscription, and also an artificial stone that are both made out of stalactite or soapstone. Very quirky, unusual objects. Now, moving on to the rest of the queens who are, I shouldn't say queens, of the royal women that are buried at Napata, this is Piankhy's pyramid here, and the rest of them are buried rather far afield across this fire riverbed of Wadi. So there's sort of a ridge over here and a ridge over here. So if you're standing at Piankhy's pyramid, and the queen's graves are kind of over here. If that seems like they're a little far afield, it's true they are, because where the red circle is the cemetery for Piankhy's horses. So the queen's got a little closer to the pyramid, but they're still kind of out there with the horse. And here's what the tombs look like during the excavation. They are not pyramids, they're simply shaft tombs, some more elaborate than the others. For example, who are these people who are buried in these tombs? They're numbered KU51 through 55, and the occupants of three of them are unknown. Two of them we know are a woman named Nefru-Pakashta and Queen Tabiri, who we know from other inscriptions. So when I say the royal women, I'm actually speculating a little bit as to whether they even are women, because they're not human remains that will dictate this. But because of Queen Tabiri, who we know as a queen, and Nefru-Pakashta, who is clearly female, based on her name, and also the similarities in the finds in these tombs, it's sort of assumed that they're all other members of female members of the royal family. But again, that's not 100% certain. So to give you an idea of the layout of these tombs, Queen Tabiri's is significantly more elaborate than the others. She has the shaft in the attached burial chamber, where the others are simply the shaft without a separate chamber. And the burials are placed on these benches in the center of the shaft. There is a group of jewelry as it was found in situ at the time of the excavations. And it gives you an idea of the way that these excavation photos have really helped in being able to reconstruct the original arrangement of some of the jewelry. So here, for example, is one of these pieces that is currently in St. Louis, a pectoral featuring a winged scarab beetle. and he's pushing a sun disk with both his front and back feet. And this is a motif that's borrowed from Egyptian art, where the scarab beetle represents the newborn sun, and the scarab pushes the sun disk across the sky. So it's a symbol of reawakening and renewal. These are part of a large series of amulets made out of faience, which is a quartz-based ceramic with copper ore mixed in with, when fired, forms just green or blue glaze. And these are very short-lived. They're basically confined to the reign of Piankhy and one other king, but they were distributed in large numbers throughout these tombs. This example is of a little guy by the name of Pataikos, who was actually a local invention in Nubia, later fled to Egypt. But he's typically shown as a bow-legged, kind of pot-bellied nude figure who's carrying knives and is supported by protective falcon babies on his shoulder. But what is interesting about this piece and many of them is that they used both sides of this to create different creatures. So they very cleverly utilized the shape of his body to fit in the wings of a winged Piankhy goddess. Now, as I mentioned, the Sundus scarab beetle, was a motif that originated in Egypt. The artists in Napata took a great deal of liberty with these and adapted them to fit their own needs. So for example, here, the sun disk is no longer even present. We have instead a floral motif. And these types of flowers are very, very common in Napatan art. They show up in various different media, and they probably had, I would guess, a function of supporting fertility and regrowth. But only even farther afield with a creature like this one, which combines the ram head of the god Amun with the wings, but now the Pateko's body has replaced the skin of the scarab beetle completely. So we have a completely heterogeneous sort of a combination of features to create an altogether new deity with these protective falcons. I thought it's cobras, aren't they? So we also have a number of these that look as the original scarab beetle did, rather Egyptian, and gods that have been borrowed from Egypt. So for example, this is Hapi, who is the god of the fertility of the Nile floods, which were the source of agriculture and the only way that people could live in the Nile Valley. And he's shown as a man, but with a sort of pendulous feminine breast. In the center, we have Amun, and this is called an aegis. It's a sort of a shield-shaped device topped by the head of the god, in this case, the ram-headed Amun. And here we have Rakhalakji, who is another shoulder god, the god associated with the sun god Ra on the horizon as he rises. And here he's got the Egyptian hieroglyph for life resting on his knees. But we also have some motifs that are very unusual. And the basic shape of this, the shape of the sacred eye of the god Horus, or the wedge eye, was a very popular image in Egyptian art. It represents the god's eye, which was lost in battle when he was avenging the murder of his father. So it was miraculously restored. So it becomes a symbol of healing and of well-being. But here again, as in that previous example, the Napatan artists have completely adapted it for all sorts of additions that bring in a whole sorts of different powers from this amulet. For example, we have, here's our scarab beetle, the floral element again, a seated deity of healing, all of this, and a smaller Uja eye in the main center, surrounded by two rearing winged cobras, which are symbols of protection against things like real cobras. So this has the combination of well-being, regeneration, and protection combined with a large number. These two goddesses are very popular in terms of these queens, and we don't know who they are. They typically do come here, one with a lioness head and one with a female head, usually shown nude. And their bodily proportions are very much a reflection of the feminine aesthetic of beauty in ancient Nubia. where Egyptians tend to like their very tall, thin, Barbie doll figure goddesses, the Nubians prefer more voluptuous goddesses. And here too, they had the same sort of downturned wings that are typical of these solar disc with horns on this one, which might associate with Hathor. We're just solar just by itself here. And they each have protective covers on their shoulders, but with different head presses. I like to think mine that represent two different aspects of the same solar goddess. And here's one that I just have to add in because he's so strange. A god, again, a deity, do not know who his deity is, but no doubt some sort of a protective deity who's got this fearsome appearance. But he's got the body of a human. And two heads that take the form of a rearing cobra, topped with the face of a falcon. So here again, a very multifaceted combination of features. Now I just want to talk about some of the other objects that were found in these tombs, and we're beginning with the tomb of Queen Tabiri. One of the things that you notice in looking at jewelry from ancient India throughout all periods is a real interest in different really exploiting the nuances and the subtleties of different types of stone. And this is very much true of the Napata women. Here we have a cat, a very noble-looking one of my favorite objects in the show, a powerful-looking cat, possibly the guy's master, we don't know, and it once had an earring through his ear. And this is made of an unusual stone, dolomite marble, which you don't usually see very much in Nubian sculpture. And this little pendant takes the form of a ritual pouring vessel called a situla, and it would have had a handle. And in full-size examples of these are often seen being used to pour libations in funerary ceremonies or other ceremonies. But in this case, they've made a little miniature version out of it and really capitalized it on this beautiful amethystine quartz with sort of semi-transparent nature. Another example of the use of colorful stone, in some cases, very recorded for a very long distance, also from this tomb of Tabiri, is this bright red jasper Isis knot, which is, represents the belt of the goddess Isis, which is tied into a knot. And this eye of Horus, a much more traditional looking example of the eye of Horus, but this is made of lapis lazuli, which had to be imported all the way from Anatolia, from the area of Turkey. So it gives you a sense of the vastness of the trade networks that were going on to get this all the way down to. In the tomb of Neferu-Kakasta, the excavators found a rare, very large silver pendant featuring the goddess Moot, and she's always identified by this hat, the tall crown that represents Upper and Lower Egypt. And she is the consort of Amun, whom we saw earlier on this theory of Piankhy. So she's very Egyptian looking in her appearance. From the same tomb, we have this is a very tiny amulet. It's about an inch tall. But when you look at it closely, it's a really fascinating object because it shows the goddess Hathor, who's identified by her wings on this. And she is nursing a Nubian woman, a Nubian royal woman, which you can tell because she's wearing the cobra on her. And there's a couple of the vulture here, while it looks kind of threatening, is actually a protective goddess. And there's a few interesting aspects of this. One of them is that this is a motif that you see in Egypt, but only with kings. And by nursing them, Hathor was giving them life. She's a goddess of motherhood and love and fertility. And here, the queen already has received the sign of life, which is in her hand. This shows you, one of the things it shows you is the importance relative of women relative to Egypt, because in Egypt it's only kings who are seen in this position, where in this case it's obviously a woman. It's also interesting the juxtaposition of the two women, because as I said just minutes ago, the Egyptians had their very tall, skinny versions of the goddesses, and this guy takes the very Egyptian body type, while the king has the much more curvaceous and voluptuous body type of the Nubian aesthetic. But actually, when I say this happened, nursing a queen, this could be a princess. It could very well be Neferu-Kakasta herself, and she may not necessarily be a queen. But finally, I'm going to move on to the jewelry from the anonymous occupant of tomb 55. And if you, I don't know if you can dig it out. In this circle, you see a kind of a straight-sided inlaid piece with it facing downward. And that is, in fact, this object, which is a large gilt silver pendant showing Amun in the form of a ram-headed sphinx sitting on top of a column. And it's one of the two that were found in this tomb. And a cache of precious metal jewelry that was found in there. And so we see, in this case, the column on which the sphinx is sitting is a very Egyptian color scheme of light blue, dark blue, and red. And this one is made of a stone called peridotite, which is a local stone found in Nubia. And it's a beautiful sort of mottled red and green, very distinctive. Now, the pose of these two sphinxes of Amun, and they obviously combine the strength and regal nature of a lion with the god Amun. And they're sitting on top of columns is a motif that you see centuries later in Greek art. And whether these are a motif that ultimately passed from Napata into Ptolemaic Egypt and then into Greece, or whether they are both inspired by a different initial source is unknown. Also, from the Tomb of the Unknown Person, five is a little malachite goddess, amulet of the goddess Ma. And she wears on her head the feather that represents justice or truth or the right world order. And it was believed that the heart of the deceased person had to be measured against that heart. And if it turned out not to be as light as the feather, and if it turned out not to be as light as the feather, that the person would not go on to the afterlife. Of course, that never happens. But here, Ma'at is made of malachite, which is, again, a beautifully colored stone, but not a particularly rare stone. One that the Egyptians use primarily to grind up and make copper. Again, it's interesting, different color stone from that Nubian artist. And then I'm going to wrap up with these two objects, also from the same group of jewels. A pair of crystal pendants that were originally designed. This one still has a gold tulip in the picture. This one, the tube has gone missing. And these were probably originally held a prayer or a spell written on either a gold sheet or papyrus, asking for protection or fertility, whatever it was that the wearer wanted. This one you may by now recognize, they have a bather with her wings on this. And it's made of a globe of rock crystal. And here we have Amun, who's missing his tall feathers, which would have been attached to this pole. In this case, it's been carved into an eight-sided shape, and there's the pole and the violin missing. Rock crystal is something that seems to have been a particularly significant material for the ancient Nubians throughout their history. Possibly because it's found in the same veins as gold is when you're mining for gold. So it probably had an association with gold, which itself was, because of its imperishability, thought to be a sacred material and the material that made up the skin of the gods and goddesses. But just about the detail on the sapphire pendant, which is, again, it's very tiny, it's under 2 inches tall. And when we, for many, many years, we assumed that the head was cast gold. But after we x-rayed it, we discovered that it is in fact made up of separate sheets of gold. The only cast part is the crown. And the rest of it is done with the repoussé technique, where you take a flat sheet of gold and press out the decoration from behind, and then add the details by etching them in, and then soldering them all together. It's hollow in the middle. And when I consider that the techniques available for soldering in antiquity were very primitive by today's standards, the fact that this artist was able to piece together these pieces of gold, here you can see where a little sharp tool was used for the details of the nostrils and the dimples. And even blown up to the size of the front of the building at St. Louis Art Museum, where it's on the banner, you can't see a single piece of evidence of this soldering, that it's absolutely seamless. And even down to the details of she's wearing the little Uriah's cobra on her brow, and it's itself wearing a little horn on this. So, and this is just a tour de force of gold working. It really is almost unsurpassed in human history. And with that, I will conclude and be happy to answer questions.
Wonderful, thank you. If anyone has any questions, please go ahead and type those into the Q&A box and we'll pop up here. And Denise, actually, if you want to go back so that you can see, that's okay, just to see that last image of your PowerPoint, that would be great. So I just wanted to ask, and I know you said that there is very little known in lots of ways for the Nubian people. Do you know what the relationships were with the, you know, the royal women? So obviously their proximity to their burial sites. Are there any other clues as to an indication of, you know, the level of power they may or may not have had?
They seem to have had considerable power. And later on in the Meroitic period, we have ruling kings who aren't even very big kings, and they're queens on their own right. But one of the things that you notice in reading the inscriptions of the Napata kings is there's a great deal of importance placed on their mothers in the succession, the chain of succession. So it seems that they often mention their mother. The mother accompanies them to their coronation. And they, within a family, they would exhaust all of the brothers, all of the male sons of a given woman before they would pass on to the next generation. So you have a king who might be succeeded by his brother, and then another brother, and another brother, and then it'll go on to one of their sons. So it's a complicated succession, but it really seems that women had a significant role. They're particularly royal mothers.
Yeah.
I like to think that the missing Queen Abar is one of the people who in 1055 is the owner of the Hathor, but of course there's absolutely no way to tell. In fact, there's or even speculating it's even a woman.
Okay. Let's see, we have, do we know if there are any other cultural reasons for why these stones were chosen? Are they indicators of trade and power?
It's a good question. It could very well be, because they certainly wouldn't have been materials that were available to everyone. And some of them, like, even if the jasper is not totally rare, but they seem to have really gone out of their way to choose really dramatic. And you see this in other, not just from these queens, but elsewhere among the jewelry in the exhibition. There's one piece that is a tiny representation of the god of the moon, Thoth, in the form of a baboon. And it's carved out of a piece of blue stone that, again, has to have been imported from all the way from probably as far away as at least Turkey. And the lapis had to come from Afghanistan. So you can see that trade is one of the big economic drivers of ancient Nubia, because all of these sites are located where dry riverbeds or wadis cut through the desert. And so they have access to Central Africa and South Africa and the Mediterranean and the Red Sea. And they can therefore control the trade of all these materials coming in when it joins the Nile Valley, from which they can ship it northward. So trade was always a big part of their economy.
Okay. Someone else has asked, what are the sizes of the amulets? Just some scale, perhaps. So, for example, the one that we have on the screen now, if you could give a guesstimate how big
this is. About 1.5 inches. On the distizia, I know you can go ahead and magnify to see how big a millimeter is. So that gives you some sense of the scale. The blue faience amulets vary a lot in size, but they're quite big, and oftentimes they're, they would be pretty heavy to wear. But they do come in different sizes. The red jasper piece is probably about 3 inches. So they're generally a pretty good size. The amulet of the goddess Hathor nursing the queen is probably just barely over an inch.
Wow, that's so small. Okay, let's see. Have you yourself been to these excavation sites?
Yes, I have. About 5 years ago, a group of us went from the museum. And I was not working on an excavation, although some conservators from the NFA have worked on excavations in this very site, conserving the paintings on the two walls. But I visited for a couple of weeks, and I got to see the sites, which was after you know, having them neglected for so long is really a treat.
Yeah, I bet. Okay, and then we also have someone who's asked, very interesting that the sun god is still being worshipped today. Have you ever done any research on this? Do you know anything about that?
I haven't actually done any research on it, to tell you the truth, but it's something that is deserving of research.
Yeah, for sure. One more. Were any of the royal women buried with Ushaptis?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, okay.
In fact, that's how we know their names, is the ones whose names we know, because they have their names on them.
Ah.
And, well, in Kent's case, that silver vessel also had a name on it. But basically, as is the case with all of the Napata rulers, the way the George Ryan investigator identified whose tomb was which was by the Ushaptis. Or other, occasional other inscribed object, but principally the Ushaptis are the only reason we know the names of many, many of these kings. People like Piankhy are famous because they left a lot of monuments because they conquered Egypt. They did a lot of building in Egypt. Likewise, the successor to Tahrir. But the only way that most of the pyramids were identified as pyramids of particular people were from the Ushaptis.
Mm.
The queen Ushaptis are nearly as fancy as the male Ushaptis, though. In fact, the big stone Ushaptis are a relatively later phenomenon. Even Piankhy has very humble little Ushaptis. They're only about, you know, 3 inches tall, and they're all moldy crayons. They're not like the Taharka ones. So I think likewise, these queens have, it's not because they're women, it's because the kings aren't very fancy at that point either, but it seems that the successors of Taharka, who was the king, was at the most powerful time of Nubian history. And he really went crazy with the big stone Ushaptis. And his successors sort of continued that, and then they ultimately went back to using the seance.
Wow. Okay, I think this is going to be our last question. What drew you to studying this kind of art?
Well, actually, I came from a background in geology, and I did my PhD at the University of Pennsylvania, and then after that, I worked for several years at the University of Pennsylvania Museum, which is now just called the Penn Museum. And they have the second largest collection of Nubian art in North America because they do sponsored excavations in Sudan. And so I got familiar with Nubian art there. And then when I had a chance to switch to the best collection of Nubian art, I took it. And it's interesting because the two collections don't overlap very much. They excavated sites of different time periods and different natures. So back in the 90s, long before my time here, we actually did an exchange with them. So they have Ushaptis of Taharka in their collection and Kerma beakers that came from here. And we have like a decorated late Neolithic pottery, some of which is in the exhibition. So we sort of rounded out each other's collections.
Huh.
But it's an interesting subject because it's sort of, I think it's like the sort of like the Etruscans or like the Minoans and Mycenaeans in Greece, because we haven't got that many written records. The art and the archaeology really have to fill in the gaps. And so that it makes the, you know, there's still so much we don't know. And every year, new excavations come up with something that completely revisits the,
Yeah, the history. A little bit like a detective work.
Yes, it is very much.
All right, well, thank you so much, Denise. This has been wonderful. And thanks to everyone who joined us today. If you're interested, the museum is hosting 2 virtual programs next week in partnership with the Gateway Korea Foundation, including a demonstration with artist Young Min Lee on June 16th and a lecture about traditional Korean women's clothing with scholar Lee Talbot on June 18th. Both of those are starting at 7 p.m. Also, on Saturday, June 19th, please join me to hear the founder and co-director of the Black Craftspeople Digital Archive, Tiffany Moman, speak about the decorative arts, architecture, and handcrafts created by African Americans in the early American South, and discuss how scholars, curators, and cultural institutions have historically neglected to highlight their stories. You can register for all of these programs and more on the museum's website under the Events tab. I do also want to say that this program has been recorded And we will be, I know that the auto captions aren't always the most correct, especially when you're talking about something so specific as Nubia. So we do go back through and edit those captions. So eventually, I would say in the coming weeks, maybe even a month, we will be able to have this up online with closed captions as well. So I just want to let everyone know that in case they were looking for specific terms. So thanks again, Denise, and have a great day, everyone.